Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and a very warm welcome on behalf of HSBC. HSBC has been a long-standing supporter of the aims of the Institute, and we are very glad to be able to reaffirm that support today. The Institute does great service as Asia's representative on the global academic stage. It provides a uniquely Asian voice to the biggest policy debates of our time, tackling the many economic, political, and technological issues that we face. It challenges assumptions, both in Asia and elsewhere, about the solutions to national and global problems. And above all, it is an invaluable counterweight to the easy consensus that we can develop when conclusions go unchallenged and strands of opinion are unaccounted for. At a time when Asia commands an unmatched prominence in global affairs, the AGI is helping to ensure that Asia's voice is as loud and influential as its actions. HSBC is both proud and privileged to have played a part in the Institute's development and to continue to help it in its mission today. The theme of this year's Asia Global Dialogue is very apposite. There's no question that we are moving towards a new global economic order. In just the past month or so, the inclusion of RMB in the IMF's special drawing rights basket, the formal launch of the AIIB, and the start of China's presidency of the G20 have all illustrated the extent to which the global center of gravity is shifting. The response of global markets to currency fluctuations and the cooling Asian economy have starkly demonstrated the extent to which Asia is now integrated into the global financial system. Traditional trade patterns continue to be redrawn, and the global response to climate change gathers pace, regalvanized by China's active participation. Technological advances are changing the way that we live and work. And governments, businesses, and communities are striving to adapt both to the new demands that are placed on them and the new opportunities that this changing world presents. These developments are posing fresh questions every day, and we all have a duty to contribute whatever expertise we can during this highly transformative time for the global economy. One man who has never shied from that challenge is Michael Spence. Michael's original, engaging, thought-provoking work, both in Asia and the US, has contributed greatly to our understanding of the changing world. His reasoned and insightful arguments on subjects like Asia's sustainable development have set him apart as the preeminent expert on the convergence between emerging regions and developed economies. He's a Nobel laureate and a world authority on market development and growth in developing countries. I can think of no better person to open this year Asia Global Dialogue, and I'm delighted to introduce him today. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Michael Spence.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very pleased to be with you. Honored to be able to start the discussion, at which I'm very much looking forward to as we delve more deeply into these subjects. And I've been honored also to have been part of Victor and William's Institute right from the start. And I'm extremely pleased and excited about the transition to Hong Kong University. I think the interaction of the Institute with the enormous resources of the university will increase dramatically its power and influence. I'm going to talk today a little bit about the condition of the global economy. I decided last night, one of our colleagues described this as towards a new economic disorder, which I thought was appropriate. So I decided not to repeat that. I think there's a question mark about whether we're going to get there. But let me say that I can't think of a time in which Asian perspectives and Asian insights in how to drive growth and transformation have been as needed as they are now, given the way the global economy is going to go. So I think there is huge potential. I'm not going to end up sounding overly optimistic about this, but there is huge potential. To eliminate poverty, I actually think that's within shooting distance. to transform economies using a variety of technologies, especially digital ones. There's a paradigm shift. It's captured very well in the book by Andy McAfee and Eric Brynjolfsson called The Second Machine Age. And what catalyzes it for me is just the enormous breakthrough in artificial intelligence and machine learning that's occurred in the last decade. I'm hoping we'll hear more about that. I think we also have the potential to counter effectively the anti-inclusiveness forces that are affecting many, many of our economies, the rising inequality, the disillusionment, and so on. But it's going to take a big effort. And I think we can make big progress, and we'll hear about it today, on measuring economic and social performance more effectively in a multidimensional fashion, and not stay focused exclusively on economic growth or per capita GDP. But the journey getting there from where we are now is going to be lengthy and complex. There are very big lags between the recognition of the potential for some of these technologies and the actual realization in the world. There's a puzzle floating around the policy discussion about productivity, and this is one of the reasons why productivity lags, and we've seen this before. Getting this all done is going to take huge changes in mindsets, in organizational forms, including business ones, and especially in patterns of investment in human capital. Now, I put this in capitals, and I apologize, but I think it's the main theme of what I want to talk about now. We are not currently on a path that leads us to getting all this done and realizing the potential in the near future. It's a global project, and to me, it's far from clear that the existing institutions and governance structures that we currently rely on are up to the task. I love this cartoon. It comes from my daughter-in-law. And basically, it's a mother talking to her husband and daughter, and it says, I'm making a list of everything we have to do before we go away so we can freak out in some kind of orderly fashion. That's sometimes the feeling I get when I look at the agenda that we face now. I chaired a commission on growth and development some 5 or 6 years ago, and the purpose of that entity was to try to collect the results of useful research and a whole lot of valuable experience, much of it in Asia, about how to develop and sustain growth patterns, inclusive growth patterns that really work. And we did the best job we can. It's always a work in progress. And I wanted to just briefly summarize what we learned from that and then butt that up against what you see when you look out today. So there were a number of economies that had sustained very high growth rates, 7%+ for 25 years or more. And there were lots of idiosyncratic features depending on the country, but there were a few things that seemed to be in common. One is they actually had strategies, not a bunch of bits and pieces of policies, but strategies that mutually reinforced each other that led to a plausible bet that the results would be accomplished. They are all characterized by high levels of investment, public and private. If you go around the world and want to sort out the countries that are not growing very well and the ones that are, a good place to start looking is the levels of investment. And the benchmarks were roughly 30% of GDP for total and 5% to 7% of GDP for the public sector part. Openness in leveraging the global economy's technology and huge markets is an obvious one. Mobile resources within the economy and structural flexibility, and a distinct attention to inclusiveness. Managing inequality, worrying about systematic exclusion of certain groups, level playing fields with respect to access to education, health, and other things that give you a chance to maximize your potential in the economy. A balanced and stable macroeconomic environment, mainly for lots of reasons, but one, creating a supportive environment for investment, which is the next point. And finally, leadership that was capable of bringing diverse groups of people together around a vision of what's possible so that they would support the policies and pay the prices in the short run to make their children and grandchildren better in the long run. Now, when I contrast that with what's going on now, it looks like almost the opposite of what we just went through. The growth patterns are neither sustainable nor inclusive. Public and private investments are way below levels needed. Leverage is rising. The McKinsey Global Institute, which has produced more studies than I can shake a stick at, all of which are useful, suggested at the time the study was done about 9 months ago that since the start of this rolling series of crises, we'd increased gross leverage in the global economy by $57 trillion. We have, in various spots, high unemployment, we have high and rising wealth and income inequality in most places, and monetary policy has certainly saved us. It succeeded in elevating asset prices. It probably produced some boost to consumption through the income effect, but last year, the impact of monetary policy on asset prices kind of ran out of steam, and we're even in a position where we might have a reset downward. So my view is we have to reverse most of those patterns. If I had to characterize the world that we're living in, one, it's short of aggregate demand. As a result, it's kind of a deflationary environment. There are large swaths of over-indebtedness, including in the country that where I live, Italy. We started the crisis with 110% debt to GDP ratio. We're at 133 or 4, and maybe stable. But that doesn't give that government much fiscal space. A balanced growth agenda in this context would be support from the ECB to keep the sovereign debt markets from going crazy again, combined with significant structural reforms to liberalize both factor and product markets, and an elevated level of public and private investment with a lot of things that go in behind that. The only thing on that list that's actually happening to any significant extent is the ECB is on board making sure that sovereign debt markets don't go crazy, and that's about it. So I said, if this were a course, and we were students, and the instructor asked us to outline a strategy for restoring in this context, in various places in the world and globally, for restoring resilient, sustainable growth patterns, I doubt most of us would give the following answer. Low interest rates for an indefinite period of time followed by a period. But that's what we're doing. So I think this promise requires both at the national, subnational, local, and significantly at the global level, a significant inflection point change in direction. Now, I think it's particularly appropriate to go back to the mission of the Fund Global Institute. The one country that has made significant movements in this direction and understands by experience the growth model is China. Now, you can have excess investment as well as deficient investment, and China's almost unique in that dimension, but China has created the institutions that were mentioned before. The One Belt, One Road, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. This is an attempt to up the levels of investment in the neighborhood, broadly defined, Central Asia, East Asia, South Asia, West Africa, and so on, and unblock some of those things and start on an international basis, something that looks like, and I think that is the right direction. I'm hoping that China uses its G20 presidency to try to bring together at least some of the pieces of the puzzle that would produce a change in the way we go about dealing with inclusive and sustainable growth patterns. Now, if I were going to try to go into detail, I'd be thrown off the stage and you're going to spend the rest of the day talking about the various pieces of this, but so let me just say one other thing. One way to look at this world is everybody is dragging everybody else down. The network structure of this global economy is different than it was 20 years ago, and we really are interdependent. If Europe doesn't grow, it's a huge economy that is a significant drag on China's tradable side of the economy, et cetera. You can do those pairwise things all over. Or if you turn that around, just as a strategy consists of mutually reinforcing policies, a synchronized attempt at generating significant changes in the growth patterns across major regions and systemically important economies would amplify the benefits of doing it in any one place. And so there really is an opportunity, I think. I mean, there's a nerdy way to say this in game theory terms, which is we're playing it right now sort of as a non-cooperative game, and there's real merit in trying to achieve a cooperative non-equilibrium, if I can put it that way. And so there is a real opportunity. China has the insight. It has the track record and credibility. Asia, more broadly, has that. And so I think there's a real chance. I hope I haven't sounded too pessimistic, but I think it's important to be realistic. We have had the SDGs. That was a big achievement. Perhaps an even bigger one was the progress that was made in Paris. But none of that is going to happen unless we get on a course that I think of as much more heavily dependent on investment. Investment in public goods, investments in people, investments in the knowledge and technology base, and so on. Some of us in this room were at Davos. I've never seen so much confusion in my life. You know, there's this technology and it's promising, but it seems to have sideswiped a lot of people in the middle class, and robots are going to put 40% of the world's the developed countries' working population, out of work, and what are we going to do about that? And by the way, the stock markets just went down another 6%. I mean, it was just all over the place. I mean, it was unbelievable. And it is confusing. But I think making the transitions on the optimistic side will be a lot easier if we not first, but at the same time, make a significant effort to restore what I call resilient growth patterns. And that is going to take a big effort and real leadership, and I think we can get a good start today. Thank you for listening to me.